Hey, dear colleagues, I think we may start the proceedings, and I'll introduce the jury members. Well, I'll start with introducing the candidate, actually. The candidate is Bogdan Kirillov. He is a fourth-year PhD student here at Skoltech. He has graduated from ITMA University as a bachelor in applied physics, and then after spending a year in the highest score of economics, which is not listed in his CV, but still has happened, he moved to Skoltech and graduated as Master of Science here at Skoltech, and then entered the PhD school. Presently, she works as a junior research scientist at Center of Precision Genome Editing and Genetic Technologies for Biomedicine at the Institute of Gene Biology. And his research interests are in diverse applications of machine learning and bioinformatics. This particular thesis is dedicated to CRISPR-Cas systems and their application in genome editing, but he has made important contributions in other areas of machine learning, biological applications of machine learning as well. So his thesis is about uncertainty quantification and neural network interpretation for studying CRISPR mechanics. Jury members, traditionally we start with our external jury members. So Dr. Marko Đorđević is an associate professor at the University of Belgrade. He's also a physicist by training. His PhD was in biophysics and bioinformatics at the Department of Physics at Columbia University. And he studies, well, it's written here that he studies CRISPR-Cas and restriction modification systems, but actually his research, I know him, so I know that his research interests are much wider. He works in various aspects of mathematical modeling of complex biological systems. He's quite prominent his home country in Serbia as a scientist, as an organizer of science. He has created the Belgrade conferences on bioinformatics, which are becoming more and more influential. And he got his support both from Serbian Ministry of Science and various European institutions. Dr. Martin Takac is an associate professor at the Mohammed bin Zayed University of Artificial Intelligence in Arabian Emirates. Before that, he worked at Lehigh University, and his bachelor and master degrees are in mathematics from the Komenos University in Slovakia. His PhD is also in mathematics at the University of Edinburgh. He has received several awards, including Best PhD Dissertation, Leslie Fox Prize, and Informed Computing Society Best Student Paper Award. And his current research interests include designing and analysis of algorithms for machine learning, application of artificial intelligence, and specifically understanding protein DNA interactions. Dr. Nikolai Kulyomin is here. He's a researcher at the Federal Research and Clinical Center of Physical Chemical Medicine of Federal Medical Biological Agency. I'm sorry, the Russian names of institutions are really complicated. He got his undergrad degree at the Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology and defended his candidate of science degree at the Institute for Information Transmission Problems. Several years ago, actually, I was the chair of the jury at that time, so it was quite successful defense, actually. I vouch for that. His research interests are in human genetics, population genetics, and various aspects of that, like risk models, genome attestation studies, and so on. He's a co-founder and chief technological officer of Xenome, a company that develops solutions for storage and distribution of genetic data. Dr. Oksana Maksimenko is the head of the Center for Precision Genome Editing and Genetic Technologies for Medicine at the Institute of Gene Biology. Actually, that's a place where Bogdan works, as far as I understand. Her research interests mainly focus on transcription factors and how they mediate long-range interactions. She has a considerable number of awards, including L'Oréal UNESCO Award back in 2010. And again, as far as I recall, I've been a member of the jury at that point. She's got European Academy of Sciences Prize for Young Scientists, Koltsov Prize for Outstanding Work in Molecular Genetics from the Russian Academy of Science, and the Prize for Young Scientists from the Moscow government. Professor Екатерина Храмеева is assistant professor here at Сколково Institute of Science and Technology. He graduated from the Department of Engineering and Bioinformatics of the Moscow State University, worked in various areas actually, and got her candidate degree again at the Institute for Information Transmission Problems. She had quite a wide network of international collaborations in Gießen on alternative splicing, in Munich on protein-protein interactions, as far as I recall. She worked with Professor Haitovich in Shanghai on analysis of lipidomic data, and she actually continues this area of research here at Skoltech. And recently, and in the Netherlands and Leiden University. Her recent research interests are mainly in the area of chromatin structure, and specifically chromatin structure and its relationship to epigenetic chromatin states in the human brain. And well, myself, the head of the jury, I am a professor here at school, a full professor here at Skoltech. Graduated from Moscow State University, got my candidate and science degrees in various institutes here in Russia. Actually, the candidate degree was not in molecular biology, doesn't matter. Research interests are in various areas of bioinformatics and molecular evolution, ranging from evolution of bacterial genomes and evolution of regulatory networks in prokaryotes, to, again, to alternative splicing and transcriptomics of developmental transcriptomics in eukaryotes. And the supervisor is, Bogdan's supervisor is Maxim Panov, who works as now is an assistant professor at the Mohammed bin Zayed University of Artificial Intelligence in Abu Dhabi. Presumably that's also United Arab Emirates. He works on uncertainty quantification for machine learning model predictions, Bayesian approaches in machine learning and graph analysis. Dr. Panov, Professor Panov has graduated from Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology, with diplomas on different aspects of machine learning. And for some time he worked as a research scientist and then later as assistant professor. Before he had to leave following some events of international scale, he worked here at Skoltech as a research scientist and assistant professor and head of the machine learning research group here at Skoltech. And Our supervisor is Professor, well, Dr. Konstantin Severinov, who is professor of molecular biology and biochemistry department at Rutgers University in the United States, head of laboratory at the Waksman Institute for Microbiology. And for some reason, his Russian affiliation is not listed here, but I think it's immensely important because Professor Severinov has organized and heads a project to sequence 100,000 human genomes from the Russian population. Major initiative. I don't think that we should forget about that. But before that, his main research interests were in various aspects of bacterial molecular biology, specifically in transcriptional regulation, defense systems, and in particular CRISPR-Cas systems, interaction of bacteria with bacteriophages, and his main contributions, his major contributions lie in these areas. His co-supervisor role is probably providing insight into the action of CRISPR-Cas system that Bogdan has been modeling. And having said that, I think I should announce the candidate's presentation. So Bogdan, please go ahead. You have about 40 minutes.
Greetings, dear colleagues. Can you hear me? Okay, so let me start with my presentation. The topic of my research is uncertain quantification and neural network interpretation for studying CRISPR mechanics. During the duration of my PhD, I have published two papers, one in nucleic acid research and another one in scientific reports. And I have participated in four conference presentations with the topics that are related to the topic of my dissertation. I have passed a number of required and auxiliary courses. Let me first draw an outline for my thesis structure. I will talk about the background, then thesis objectives, and I will explain the problem setups and problems that I have been studying in this during this thesis program with the methods explained as I explain the problems that I was solving. And after that, I will give some conclusions and answer some questions from the audience and of my reviewers. The methodology that I used for the thesis research is application of advanced machine learning methods, such as capsule networks, Gaussian processes, and deep kernel learning. I was working on an application of uncertainty quantification towards gene editing experiment design, and also I was working with explainable machine learning. Before I go to the problems that I was solving, let me talk a little bit about the background. The main system that I was studying is CRISPR-Cas system, which is believed to be a defense system for bacteria, an acquired immune system. This system has a lot of functions that target adversarial DNAs and viral particles and adversarial plasmids, but it also has some different other uses and a lot of cases of adaptation. The CRISPR-Cas systems is organized in a CRISPR array, which contains the information required for acquired immunity, and several of the genes which encode CRISPR-associated proteins. Here you can see the structure, a typical structure of a CRISPR-Cas locus, where the spacers come from different sources, for example, phage proteins, capsid proteins, and the repeats are used to facilitate production of CRISPR RNA, and also a number of Cas genes that encode proteins that perform the functions in the CRISPR-Cas system. The CRISPR-Cas system has primarily three major uses, three major modes of operation. The first is adaptation, where the foreign genetic information is getting added into CRISPR array by the use of Cas1, Cas2, and other proteins. It's required to store the genetic information to target foreign elements further during the preparation of interference. CRNA processing, which involves generation and maturation of CRISPR RNA, which is used to target phages and plasmids. And interference. Interference is actual targeting where the system forms Cas protein and RNA complex, which destroys phages and other adversarial elements for the bacteria. We usually classify evolutionary CRISPR-Cas systems into two classes by the structure of its interference module. For the first class, interference module consists of several different proteins, and for the second class, it consists of single protein. And the current dissertation is devoted to class two systems, where the protein that performs interference is Cas9 or Cas12. There are different ways to construct adaptation complex. And there is primed adaptation and naive adaptation. When naive adaptation happens, when the bacterium gets for the first time, it meets a new kind of contaminant, and primed adaptation happens when there is already an ongoing interference process inside the bacteria. The interference part requires a special target inside the phage genome, and here you can see the structure of such target. The important part here is that we study two proteins. We study SpCas9 and AsCas12, Cas12a, which was formerly known as CPF1. They are kind of similar in their target sequence, but they are different in which in where the PEM is located, protospacer adjacent motif, which is a binding site, and where the seed region is located. The seed region is mechanically required part of target. Of target site where the process of interference tolerates no mismatches. Usually, the protein searches for the target by 1D diffusion, then it recognizes the PEM, then it starts to unwind the DNA and form the and try to recognize the target. And if there are some mismatches inside the target sequence and its journey, then the interference, the double strand break, should not happen. But this process is stochastic and it's prone to errors. There are usually two kinds of errors. The first one is the lack of cleavage on a perfectly matching target site. And the second one is the cleavage at target site there where are some mismatches. And when we design experiment for biotechnological application of CRISPR-Cas, We would like to select such journeys for the targets that are present in our gene. So those journeys would maximize probability of on-target cleavage and minimize the number of potential off-target cleavages. For example, outside of the target gene in the genome. And this is the problem that I was that I'm trying to solve during this dissertation. And there are a number of solutions for that, which start from rule-based tools, simple rule-based tools. For example, there is a simple rule that requires a good journey to have high GC content. But it's not that accurate. So people developed classical machine learning tools, black box and white box deep learning. And in this dissertation, I present you the next step in the evolution of journey evaluation tools. These objectives are about construction of classification models for off-target events. Construction of model for cleavage efficiency estimation for Cas9 and Cas12, exploration of sequence determinants, and characterization of diversity for off-target events, because off-target events turns out they are not the same, they are quite diverse. So let me tell you about the way I set up the problems. We have two problems on this thesis. The first one is what I call off-target event detection, where the input is a pair of sequences and the task is binary classification, where one label zero is there would be no cleavage, no off-target cleavage, and one there will be off-target cleavage. And CRISPR-Cas cleavage efficiency prediction, which is a regression problem, where we would like to predict essentially the probability of successful result. For both problems, for both models, this is how the input data look like. They are sequences of journey and of target, which are one-hot encoded and converted into pictures. For on-target models, for cleavage efficiency prediction for on-target models, we use only one sequence, but for off-target cleavage efficiency prediction and for off-target event detection, we use two sequences. Let me start first with off-target detection. There is a thing with this whole area of research about journey evaluation, is that it kind of got stagnant. The classical methods like machine learning without deep learning or even black box deep learning provides outputs without any kind of explanation, which makes them suspicious and that people usually don't trust them. And the performance of those methods is really, really similar to each other. Almost like if we got to the limits of the prediction of the prediction quality, and the two possible innovations that can break us out of it are better wet lab methods with which I cannot help you. I'm a bioinformatician, and information beyond label prediction. So maybe a different class of architectures would help. I did an extensive literature search, and from that literature search, I decided to model off-target detection as supervised anomaly detection, which is a binary classification where there are two classes, and one is very, very abundant, and one is very, very rare. For example, an abundant class is not an off-target, and rare class is off-target. Supervised anomaly detection is a well-studied problem with various methods designed to solve it, but all those methods suffer from limitation of labeled data, lack of labeled data, embossed data, and difficulties in feature selection. So I proceeded with literature search further and decided to use capsule networks, which are an extension of convolutional networks designed to solve a problem of reversing the rendering process, but they are kind of brain-like in their design, and why I will explain a little bit later. So we have the input here as our sequences, and the outputs are not single digits probabilities for it being a normal class or anomaly, but a vector of digits whose norm, norm of which vector is the probability of a class. But the digits and the vector, they provide some sort of other useful information that helps to distinguish the class. The capsule networks work by using routing by agreement. We have primary capsules. I'm not sure that you can see it. We have primary capsules, which are encoded in green on the left, and we have two secondary capsules. And between them, there is a routing table. At the beginning, the routing table is random, but when we start to train it, when it gets positive example, the coefficients in routing table change. So the weight of this connection becomes stronger, and the weight of connection to the secondary capsule becomes weaker. The same, but in reverse goes for negative example. And in the end, we have this polarized routing table, which where the primary capsules connect that correspond to parts of positive class connect only to positive secondary capsules, and for negative is the same. Why it's relevant for bioinformatics? That kind of, those models can recognize overlapping objects in the picture. What about in bioinformatics? We have, of course, overlapping motifs. So maybe it could work for overlapping motifs. That was my thinking when I was selecting this kind of model. But unfortunately, plain capsules do not solve off-target detection. They give a pretty poor result, mostly because it's a really, really imbalanced task. But they have a polarization property. Maybe we can use this kind of polarization to detect off targets better than we can with the usual computation of labels and capsule network. And what do we need for that? We need some sort of statistic that would distinguish common and rare objects. And we need some sort of decision rule to classify off targets. And remember that coupling coefficient table, I'm calling it a table, but it's not really a table. It's a tensor of some complex shape. So we need to design the statistic carefully. Remember that, and let's get into economics for of all places. This kind of routing may be thought as the voting process, where primary capsules vote for secondary capsules, for example, with their money. And when we have inequality in economics, we usually use Gini and Palmer coefficients to measure that inequality, where Gini coefficient is defined as this proportion of covered area in the cumulative distribution of people with income, and Palmer coefficient is a fraction of distribution tails. So we can probably use Gini coefficients to study this economy. And turns out, yes, we actually can if we sum. Sum of the individual coefficients in the routing table, so we get the total vote of primary capsule for secondary capsule. We can use the statistic and compute Gini and Palmer coefficient, and turns out that despite that the quality of prediction of plain capsule network is poor, the quality of prediction, the quality of distinguishing normal and anomalous cases for normal and anomalous capsule is quite good actually. And for anomalous capsules, it is better, so we use anomalous capsule. Turns out that this method works quite well, and Palmer and Gini and another benchmark, I will explain benchmarks if you ask me a little bit after I'm done with the whole talk. Palmer and Gini outperform plain capsules, so well, the advantage of inequality-based metrics is shown. But this method, I was designing it for off-targets, but it actually can be used for solution for, it's a general method for anomaly detection. So I did what every machine learning scientist would do. I studied its performance on benchmark datasets and on some real data from skin lesions, which is a pictures dataset for that kind of problems. And also our methods outperform the competition, the benchmarks, the baseline methods. I will explain it if you ask me after the majority of the talk. We are able to solve off-target event detection with capsule networks. Let's go to cleavage efficiency estimations, because we are not only interested in deciding whether it's off-target or not, but also we are interested in determining actual cleavage efficiency. And there is another problem. Plain capsule networks are not suitable for solving regression tasks. They are defined for classification tasks only. So we need to redesign them to solve regression. And maybe, by doing that, we can get something more than just a point estimate of our cleavage efficiency. Maybe we can get confidence intervals from it. There are a number of sources of error in this in ML models, and ideally we would like not only to predict our value, but also to get an estimate of how much the model is incorrect. And for that we do uncertainty quantification. We need to do an uncertainty aware model. I performed a literature search again, and with that I stumbled upon Gaussian processes, which are a generalization of neural networks for cases where we have infinitely wide layer. They also can be stacked as typical layers in neural networks. They are defined by setting a mean function and covariance function. And they can provide us with the uncertainty aware, with the confidence interval that we want. My final architecture for cleavage efficiency estimation is as follows. I use some convolutional layers for preprocessing or recurrent layers. I use capsule networks to extract features. I use Gaussian process to regress the cleavage efficiency, and I get mean and variance, which I can use to compute the confidence interval. How does it work? Actually, it works quite well. It gets state-of-the-art results, or close to state-of-the-art results. So you can see here the learning curve, where on the x-axis there is training set size on the left one, and on the y-axis is Spearman correlation on the test set. And the dashed lines show the performance of Original are the methods original ones that that were pro, pro, that were done by the people who whose data set I use, and mine models are in the learning curves, and you can see that we do get some very close quality, and we get it with less data, just a fraction of the data. And we also can see that if we are looking at the reduction of uncertainty, we also can see that different data sets have different levels of background noise. This kind of model I adapted Guide Home, it provides reliable confidence intervals, and by that I mean that for a test set, it should be should be about 68% of test set should be between min plus sigma and min minus sigma. 95% should be between min plus two sigmas and min minus two sigmas, and so on. Here you can see that we actually do perform as we promised. For some cases we perform a little bit worse. So we can solve cleavage efficiency prediction with uncertainty aware models. What does it give us? It gives us some funny results. The first result is the existence of previously unknown diversity of target sites. Turns out that if we use the variance of cleavage efficiency of activity, we get that we have four major types of potential targets. And the most of targets are inefficient, so they perform way less than a non-target would perform. But some are efficient, and they should be avoided in any experiment. Also, some are predictable, so we actually can be pretty sure about the prediction of their efficiency. But some are unpredictable, and they are better to be avoided as well, because we can't say anything about them other than we may be wrong with assessment of their efficiency. So this can be this is an actionable thing that can be used by people who do gene editing experiment design. That is the first thing. Another thing is that we actually can additionally validate this kind of models by using explainable machine learning. So we have some sort of a control for our machine learning model. Remember what I was talking about outputting data without an explanation. What we need is a method to output some explanation. It also has to be model agnostic and easy to compute. During the literature search, I have found a method called accumulated local effect, which basically provides you with values that show the effect of certain nucleotide on certain spot in the sequence. To simplify this for people who work in biology, we may to use softmax function to convert it into probability and visualize the probability distribution over nucleotides and the sequence with logo sequences. And what do we have here? For the first time, we have, using explainable machine learning, rediscovered a known biological fact about CRISPR-Cas systems, is their preference on seed region, the importance of seed region for the prediction, and their preference for a high GC content. This is true for On target cleavage models, it shows on mean prediction, it also shows on the variance, but the patterns are reversed. And it's also true for Cas12a models, but of course the seed region and the PEM is in the different part of the input. And of course for the variance, the patterns are reversed. And it also true for off-target cleavage efficiency models, not only for on-target cleavage efficiency models, which were trained on different data set. And it shows that our results are not data specific, but Cas effector specific, which shows that we can actually use explainable machine learning to get some rather interesting biology out of those systems. So the main conclusion from this my thesis research is that we can use deep learning based methods for, we have introduced deep learning based methods for cleavage efficiency prediction. We have solved off-target event detection. Uncertainty quantification helped us to highlight the hidden diversity of off-target events. And we have rediscovered the dependency of cleavage on seed region, which is a well-known biological fact that independently validates our findings. And it was done, I forgot to say, it was done without any kind of supervision. So the model did not know the existence that there is such a thing of seed region. It has rediscovered it independently. We have done some effector and cell line specific models based on publicly available data sets. And we also developed a general method for anomaly detection. This the sources code and the references for this presentation. You can scan the QR codes. This is the Google Colab tool. You also can scan the QR code for if you want to play with it. And the final thing that I want to say is a little bit of case study. I understand that my work is quite abstract, so this case study is required so I can show how it can be applied for basic molecular biology tasks with CRISPR-Cas systems. A classical, I would say, example is CCR5 knockout in humans. We know the deletion of CCR5 gene, which is a chemokine receptor in white blood cells. It's deletion mutation, a naturally occurring mutation. Gives some resistance to HIV and some susceptibility for Western Nile fever. This is the sequence of the gene. Let's use our software to find top five active gRNAs to knock it out. We use our software to minimize on-target efficiency, to maximize off-target efficiency, on-target efficiency. We just paste the gene, select the model, and get top five active gRNAs. According to the cleavage efficiency prediction variance plot, we are not really interested in number 98 because it's unpredictable. So we are interested in four. Let's get the off-target data for them. We need to download it and add it into our added into FlashFry, for example, which is a software that uses that searches for all potential off-target sites for given gRNAs. It does not perform any kind of deep learning. It's not my tool. It's a tool that is used by the community. We run it locally. We get our potential off-targets, and we need to filter them with our software. So we upload it, select the models, we get the number of off-targets, the proportion of inefficient off-targets, the proportion of highly predictable off-targets, and the proportion of the off-targets that both inefficient and predictable. And from that, we can use it, use this information to select the best of targets, which should have the least amount of the best journeys, which should have the least amount of targets. And if we can choose between them, it should have also very low active and low variance of targets if it has them. So we, with that, we have selected two journeys, which we can use in experiment to mock out the CR5G. So this is what was done in this, this research. I would like to say thank you for all people involved, for Ekaterina Savitskaya, God bless her soul, for Maxim Panov and Konstantin Severinov, for Svetlana Shabalina and Eugene Kunin, who are not there. I also would like to thank all the people of SCOTEC, Institute of Gene Biology, National Institute of Health, for their support. And I would like to thank Technology Innovation Institute of Abu Dhabi for providing funds for open access publishing. And special thanks goes to all subscribers of my Telegram channel, Bioinformatica Lab. Thank you very much. I am ready to answer the questions. Oh, yeah, I forgot. I have some other notable projects that I am participating in. It's about the finished one is about transcranial direct current simulation. Spoiler alert, it does not improve memory. The project about clostridioid difficile genotyping, we need to publish this paper finally. A project about active learning, which is proceeding with ongoing wet lab experiments. A project about oxygen distribution in 3D printed bioconstructs, which is also in final stages of preparation. And low cost 3D bioprinter conversion, which is under development. And now I'm ready to answer questions. Thank you very much.
Get away with this slide, because it's my job to suggest to ask questions.
Okay,
not
I'm
yours.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
Now, let's go to conclusions. Okay, cool. So now we have questions from the jury. And in the same order, Professor Georgievich, please, your comments.
Hello, Bogdan. So can you hear me?
Can you just confirm that you hear me? Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Okay. So first, thanks for the nice presentation and also for, I think, very good PhD thesis. And I have two questions, actually. So the first one is about the size of the data set. So if I remember from the thesis, it is quite large. The first is about the size of the data set. If I remember from the thesis, it is quite large, something like 30,000 or 40,000 data that you have. And at least in my experience in biology, typically we do not have that large data set. It's like, for example, a few thousands data that we have at best. So it comes to the question that I also had in my review comments. What would happen? Did you try if you would sort of artificially reduce your data set that, you know, if you go from larger data set to smaller data set, how these models that you develop perform? Because at some point I would, you know, expect that rather than neural networks, perhaps some more classical machine learning modeling like random forest, gradient boost, and things like that would start to perform better. So do you have some sense on that, on how the models that you develop depend on the size of the data set? So this is the first question.
Yes, I have that. Elena, can you please show the presentation? Yes, yes. So I have the clicker doesn't work. Oh, it works only in full screen mode. So I have here exactly for that reason I have the learning curve, which shows us the behavior of training as it gets more and more data. We start from a small fraction of the whole data set, and we get to the whole data set. So as you can see, for the majority of the data sets, it gets saturated at about 10 to 15,000 of examples. But we can train it on smaller data set. For example, for Cas12 journey target pair, we had about 1,500 examples in the training set at the max. Yeah, in that case it would also work. It would also get trained. But the influence of label noise may be much higher, and that influence of label noise would also affect the estimation of not only the mean but also the variance of our output. So the more data is the better, but usually it saturates at about 10 to 15,000 of examples. Yes, okay, so that's my answer.
And do we have results like that also for the classification problem? Because what you're showing here is regression. With this capsule network, did you also try to see the effect of the data size?
For the classification problem, I need to go to my supplementary, I guess, to answer this question. I also have...
It doesn't matter. You can just say in words what is the.
Yeah, it's just we were not really focused on the sheer size of the data set, but for the proportion of anomalies in the data set. So we did not study the size of the data set. We did not do this learning curves, but we did study the proportion of anomalies, which provides us some insights into how it would work. Usually, I would say that capsule networks are trainable with hundreds of examples, but in that case, the data set should be balanced well if you are talking about classification. That's my answer.
Okay, well, thank you. And actually, the second question, it comes to possible extensions of what you have done here. So in some ways, this problem reminds me to the problem of prediction of transcription factor binding sites, regulatory elements in genome. Because, you know, you have relatively few of these binding sites, like on the order of few tens or hundreds or something like that. And then you have, so these are the places where transcription factor should bind. And then there is the entire genome where the transcription factor should not bind. So in some sense, it seems that binding sites you can treat as anomalies, right? Also, you know, the output, these logos that you get out of your method, it also reminds very much to weight matrices and what you typically learn, you know, when you're considering predicting transcription factor binding sites. So I was just thinking if you perhaps thought of applying the methods that you have developed here to this problem, because I think it's still not solved very, very well. There are a lot of false positives and things like that.
Yes, we can apply those methods. For example, I can give you some possible study design for it. For example, we may reproduce DeepBind with Guide Home as base model, but it's kind of boring. so we would do it with like some 2023 methods like fine tuning and stuff. So let us train Guide Home like foundational model on a lot of data on a large chunk of training set. And then we for each kind of binding site, for each kind of transcription factor, we may train an adapter with LoRa. So we can add those adapters to the foundational model and use them to predict the binding site for this transcription factor. For example, that kind of experimental that kind of site design is completely possible. Yes, so we can do that. Yes.
Okay, thank you. So that's also, thank you again for the nice presentation, nice PhD thesis and clear answers. So I'm done with my questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marco. I really appreciate your kind words and your help and your guidance. Thank you.
Actually, you should basically ask a question now. I don't know even what the order is. But can you ask a question now?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so I think that on your slide 42, can you go to slide
22, right?
42, 42.
42.
Yeah. I think it was 42 or 43. So you go to slide 42.
Yes, yes, I will when my clicker gets working.
Actually, 40, 44, can you go like more, this one, 43, sorry.
Okay.
So basically in this case, you have this diagram with the mean and the variance of this method. So it has some very nice structure. Could you maybe explain like why basically this is happening or what does it mean?
The shape of the spot, as far as I understand, comes from the formulas for Gaussian processes. It uses like normal distribution to approximate our function and to approximate the confidence intervals. So these shapes are arbitrary as you would expect. They just come from the methods that we use to estimate our values. How exactly they arrive here? It's a much harder question, which I would need to think about how to answer it with some pen and paper, and I would like not to do that. But simple answer is that it's because I use Gaussian process, and if I would use some sort of other framework for confidence intervals, the shape of the plot would look different, a little bit different. Something like that. That's my answer.
I just thought if you already thought about this one or not, but that's fine. Can we go now to slide 40? And this one here. So basically you have this like learning curves, right?
And
I see that, you know, like some of them basically are finishing sooner than later. So what is the data set for all those experiments? Are the same data set of 50,000 or they're different?
Each data set has different size. For example, DeepHF is about 55,000 totally. So this is the size of training set, so I used a fraction of it. So the training set is a little bit more than 40,000 for DeepHF. DeepCPF is smaller, GCRISPR is even smaller, Cas9 and Cas12 journey target pairs are also, Cas9 journey target pairs is about 23,000. And Cas12a is about 1,000 and a half. So the different training sizes means that they the learning curves saturate differently. Well, not saturate, but stop differently. Yes.
Okay. Also maybe different question. Basically, you can see that the black line, it almost achieves the dashed line, right? So basically, almost achieve the baseline, right?
The dashed lines is the baseline. Yes.
Yes. So question here: if you try to run your method, let's say multiple times for multiple seeds and so on, to somehow see that maybe you are already achieving this baseline.
Yes. It would be a little bit better to do that with some sort of error bar. For example, for 10 seeds to compute the plot for 10 seeds and show it. It would be a lot of computations. So for the paper, we did not do it. This is what we got for the paper, because it would take a lot of time to compute.
Okay, thank you very much. Actually, it was very nice. I really like it a lot. Thank you very much for your questions. And
thank you very much, Martin. Thank you very much for your questions. Thank you.
Yeah. Let me be next. Do you hear me?
Yes, we hear you loud and clear.
Okay. Bogdan, thank you very much for the excellent presentation. The main questions that remained after reading the dissertation were completely addressed by you. Your responses and the corrections made to the dissertation text fully satisfied me. Now I would like to ask slightly unrelated questions about possible development of your models. First question, have you thought using your approach to learn a model for the Cas13 editing system, which recognizes and cleaves RNA targets, and what potential problems could you arise with such model?
I actually have tried to train this kind of models on Cas13. I did not yet come to concluding results on that, so this is ongoing work. But I can comment on that. The problem with Cas13 is that it targets RNA, and RNA perform some mechanical function. They have a secondary structure which gives another dimension of to targeting it with Cas13 because due to its strange secondary structure, Cas13 may fail to connect to it. So that's for Cas13 building models with that design would be harder. But I think it's doable. But we need to use RNA features like binding energy and other RNA features in addition to sequence. Yes.
Thank you. My second question is about base editors utilized CRISPR-Cas9 that are directed towards editing pair CG into TA or AT to DC with corresponding deaminase. Currently, there are third generation base editors that use a NiCas variant of the Cas9 protein, which introduces one break in non-editing chain of DNA. And such Cas9 is fused with the deaminase. Modification is made to the base located at a distance of about 10-15 nucleotides from the PEM. At the same time, the PEM site match with the classic one for Cas9. And does your model work as is for such system, or do you think a separate model needs to be trained for this variant?
I think that Given that these models, they predict targeting and cleavage and do not distinguish between cases where targeting happened but cleavage did not happen, and the cases where targeting happened and cleavage targeting did not happen, I'm sorry. That is this an interesting question. I would experiment with running them as is, of course. But ideally, we would need a separate data set and separate study for modern base editors. But for the first generation of base editors, I would say pretty much the same thing that I would say for DeadCas9, that this model is applicable. Yeah, but for the new ones that involve a lot of changes into the protein itself, I'm not sure. We would need a separate study, but we may try to use the models as this. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Thank you. And the last question. Your work focuses on human cell lines. In your opinion, will the model remain correct with the genomes of other organisms?
Only an experiment will tell, I would say. The thing is that I focus on working with human cell lines just because I have a lot of data available for human cell lines. The models are cell line dependent, and they usually do not really correspond with their predictions. If you are using different models, they may not agree in many cases. So I would say that for animal cell lines, for Drosophila cell lines, we would need separate models. But we may try to use that because we don't have anything better. Yes.
Thank you so much for the nice work.
Thank you very much, Oksana. Thank you very much for being here and for your questions. Thank you.
Thank you for the great work and excellent presentation. I had two questions during their revision, and I've found a little minor change synthesis for these questions, but in fact, I'm a little bit disappointed why you have not placed on your slideshow, on your slides, the technical parameters of
the main slide. I actually have placed it, but in my supplementary.
Thank you. Yes, so I think that this slide, this technical slide, should be in every computer science work, and I think your work is also in the computer science field. So thank you, and I think now we can use your work without any questions how we should install it and run. The second question was about how you combine different data sets, but in fact I see that you count an errors on different data sets, but you haven't combined them between. Yes, as I understand.
This is because that I don't use cross data set testing, so I don't really need to combine the errors based on different data sets. I tried to reproduce the original pipelines as closely as possible, just using my models instead of theirs. I think that I did my best work to minimize possible additional errors that come from the unmatching parts of the pipeline.
Thank you. Thank you for the answer, I think.
Thank you very much, Nikolai.
Thank you for a nice presentation. I had two questions in my review, well, more, but two major ones in my review report. Fully satisfied with your answers and the thesis changes a lot, but maybe we could discuss them briefly for everyone to see. In the first question, I was criticizing tenfold cross-validation procedure because it often creates overfitting. So maybe you could comment on that.
Yeah, I think that I initially did not want to do tenfold cross-validation. It was asked by the reviewer. So, as usual, if you see something in the paper which does not fit there, most likely it was asked to be done by the reviewer. So, yeah, that is the case. I agree fully with your comments on cross-validation. It's for that kind of data is usually not a good idea in general. And for I don't use cross data set validation as you told me to do because there are no two data sets from different labs that are equal in both their method preprocessing and cell line. Unfortunately, I just can't do it. But if we consider this explanations. We may see that the explanations for on-target cleavage, the models were trained on one kind of data, for off-target cleavage on different kind of data, and they provide more or less the same picture of importance of seed region and GC content. So
this is good to know. Yeah,
that is kind of cross dataset validation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. It's better than this tenfold cross-validation for sure, and more robust way to estimate the accuracy of the method. And the second, question was, let me check.
About the baselines.
I was asking that sometimes using complicated models like neural networks produces a good prediction accuracy, but using simple models like logistic regression also produces a good accuracy. So I was just curious, what was your case? And
I personally, when I was preparing the paper, the paper for Guide Home, not the other one. I did not do any baselines because the extensive study of the baselines was done by other people whose data I used. But especially to answer this question, I did it for one data set for DeepHF, and I also did for gCRISPR for classification task. Here you can see the comparison for the most basic baseline for that is GC content, which provides us with miserable Spearman correlation. The Guide Home result is quite good. Linear regression gives us decent correlation, I guess. Gradient boosting gives us almost the ones that I used. Actually, DeepHF paper did use gradient boosting also in addition to deep learning. The thing is that this field, if you consider performance of the model, it stagnates. The performance does not get better by a large margin. They get only like incrementally better.
Yeah.
This is the problem of data. We basically reached a Bayesian error rate for that kind of data. We can't really learn more because there is a substantial amount of noise in this kind of data. So what we really need is better experiments to get more clean data. Or we need the models that provide us not only with the point estimate, but with something else. Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting to see that the last case logistic regression on the CRISPR data set gives very good
results. Yes, for that data set, logistic regression that I did was quite good, and their logistic regression, I guess, was worse. I don't know why.
Sometimes it happens. Thank you very much. I'm fully satisfied. And thank you for this additional analysis.
Thank you very much, Katerina.
Okay. We've actually had mainly stylistic disagreements. All substantial stuff have been discussed during the previous years when I was a member of Bogdan's individual doctoral committee. So we still have some stylistic disagreements.
Yes,
we do. But I would rather let them stay as is, and we'll discuss it probably later in a private manner. Aside of that, I've had a number of substantial comments about this project, but as I've already said, they have been resolved during all the previous years, so I have nothing to ask at that moment. Any questions from the audience? See none, so the supervisors. And they have officially asked all members of the jury whether they are satisfied with the responses. Okay, so let's fix it that all questions have been addressed adequately. And now, any questions from the audience? See none, so the supervisors, please. Dr. Panov?
Yeah, do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So, first of all, I would like to thank all the members of the committee, jury, and everyone involved in the process for helping and for participating. And following the traditions, I wouldn't say much about the Bogdan's like thesis, but more will speak about himself. So I was very fortunate that Bogdan approached me, I guess, 4 years ago to be a co-supervisor of his thesis from a machine learning part. For me, it was an interesting adventure because I was never working on, or almost never working on, biological problems before. And I should say that I had an extremely positive experience of working with Bogdan, because Bogdan is, I would say, a unique scientist in terms of the number of ideas he is generating. And I would say that in my experience, a supervisor is responsible for a significant share of like research and ideas in the work of a student, but in this case, I think I can confidently say that like 95% of ideas from a machine learning side were by Bogdan, and I was just mainly responsible to shape it a little bit and probably to add a little bit of broadness to some of the studies. So I'm fully confident that Bogdan is already an established scientist and very prolific scientists, as you've seen, on top of the projects which are inside the paper, inside the thesis, there are also quite a few other projects which are all related to biotechnology, bioinformatics, really broad scope of research, and some of the results there are interesting as well, I think. So to sum up, yeah, I think Bogdan did a great job, and I think he will have very good scientific career in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maxim, for your kind words.
The time, yes, and so on. I'm gonna second what Maxim said. So Bogdan and I, we know each other for 7 years, maybe 8 years by now. where he was fished out from a poster session on the Moscow State University biological faculty corridor, and then he never looked back. I concur that he is has lots of initiative, and it's very original in the way he thinks and the way he tackles scientific problems. He also, fortunately, during all these years, he ultimately, it was a slow curve, but he became more understandable to us, the biologists. In fact, but on the other hand, he didn't have to be. So in a way, his comparative to machine learning and computational skills lack of biological knowledge works to an advantage, because it becomes a litmus test for us for all the multiple projects that he worked on. His initial lack of deep understanding was an asset for us, because when we saw that his ideas made sense once he completed his calculations biologically to us, that became a guarantee that he can then go free and explore further. Right. So yes, we didn't understand all that he did, but the results of what he did turned out to be useful to the practitioners. So in this sense, I have utmost trust in what he does, and this is useful. In fact, after these procedures, I hope I'm going to make him a job offer that he wouldn't be able to refuse. So yeah, I think this is great work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Konstantin Viktorovich.
So do you colleagues online, Professor Panov, and I see some audience members. We will now operate a separate breakout room only for the jury members, but you are most welcome to stay online with us and wait once we're back with the announcement of the results.
И доктор Богданов, I congratulate you on your successful defense and welcome to the community, not to the world.
Dear colleagues, I would like to express my deepest gratitude for all of you. I'm standing here. I'm really excited about here, being here with you, and I thank you from all of my heart for this beautiful opportunity. From the bottom of my heart, thank you for this great opportunity.